Hello everyone, this is TE359, that is Theory of Electrical Machine class. Now today we will see how we can control DC motor speed. Okay. Now we start from these two equations. Okay. The expression for back EMF developed in the armature of a DC motor is given as follows. So these are two equation. From these two equation we will start. First one is E equal to P phi Z n by 60 A, and second one is E equal to V minus Ia Ra. So Ia Ra is armature current and armature resistance. So this is the IRA, that is the back EMF drop in a armature, okay, and the terminal voltage minus this one. So that is our expression. So from these two expression we will start how DC motor speed control can be done. Now from, as we can see, both the equation having E equal to, so both are E equal to this one. So as E equal to is the expression of both, so we can write this equal to this one. So from here P, that is number of pole that is fixed for a motor, this is fixed for a motor, it is also fixed. So whatever all the fixed whose number is fixed, that is we can say constant, that will take as K. Only thing is given as phi and N. So proportional constant we take as K. So K phi N, this is equal to V minus IR. So from this K phi we take to the bottom side, and we can see that A equal to V minus IRA by K phi. So this is the expression of speed. Now we can see the expression of speed. This is the formula. Here we can have three factor, I mean three term is there which can affect the speed. Number one is, we can see V. So that means if we increase V, N will increase, okay. If we decrease V, our speed will decrease. So this has something proportional relationship with V. Second, so this is voltage control. The effect, the process is voltage control. If we increase or decrease voltage, we can accordingly increase or decrease the speed. Next is IARA term. Now we can see that this IARA term is given with a negative. Okay, so this both term belongs to armature. IA belongs to armature current, RA belongs to armature resistance. So if this is more, as there is a negative symbol, we can see this is a negative symbol. As there is a negative symbol, so if this term increases, our speed will decrease, and if this term decreases, speed will increase. So this term has something opposite relationship with speed. And next is our phi, or we can say K is constant. This is our third factor, phi, and it is called flux control. So we can see it is at the lower side, so we are dividing. So if phi is less, N will be more, and if phi is more, N will be less. So this is another flux control method by which we can change the speed. So from the equation directly we can see it can be either voltage controlled or it can be either armature controlled or it can be flux controlled. These three type of control we can have if we want to control the speed of a DC motor. Now coming to next slide, the description is given here. K is the constant of proportionality and equal to Z by 60A. Now the above expression for speed, the speed can be varied by varying the applied voltage V, field flux phi and resistance of the armature. This I already told. It is clear that speed is directly proportional to the supply voltage V. So the speed increases with increase in voltage V and vice versa. The speed is inversely proportional to the field flux phi. So speed decreases as the flux phi increases and vice versa. The important characteristics of DC motors are, now we are coming to the characteristics of DC motor. There are three type of motor, that is series motor, shunt motor and compound motor. And for each kind of DC motor we have three characteristics. So we have total 3 × 3, 9 characteristics curve. The first one is speed armature current. Armature current is also called load. So speed versus armature current characteristics. So this one is the first. Second is one is the torque versus armature current characteristics. Third is the speed versus torque characteristics. So this we'll do one by one. It is very much important to know the characteristics mentioned above for different types of DC motors, because it enables the selection of a specific type of DC motor for specific purpose. If we know for which characteristics, which type of DC motor, that is shunt, series or compound, which type of DC motor behaves in which way, if we know, then only we can select a particular type of motor for a particular application. Otherwise, we cannot select. So, this characteristics curve is very important. Now, we will see by one by one. We will see one by one. We first start with DC shunt motor. So, we know the shunt, it is in parallel. So we can see armature and shunt, they are in parallel. So this is the supply voltage, is the positive point, is the negative point. So from the positive point of supply voltage, this is the flow of current, this is the load current IL, and it is going in current is going in two directions. This is IA, so this is the armature current, and this is IF. So it is for the shunt resistance. This shunt coil having the current IF in this direction, and back EMF has the opposite polarity, so it is given upward arrow, that's why. So this is the construction of this shunt motor. Now this is the first characteristics, that is IA versus N characteristics. So we can see it is not almost parallel, it is little bit down with the full load point. So this characteristics is little bit down, but not very much down. So speed versus armature current or load characteristics, For DC motor we know that N equal to V minus IR by K phi. So that means if IA increase, if IA is increasing, this term is increasing. If this term is increasing, V minus this one, it will be decrease. So N will be decrease little bit. So you can see as IA increases, N decreases. A DC shunt motor is connected across the mains having supply voltage V. This supply voltage is assumed to be constant. The field winding is connected across the armature as shown in the previous figure. The magnitude flux phi produced by field current IF will be constant as V remain constant. But in actual practice, the air gap flux is slightly reduced due to the effect of armature reaction. Okay, so in normal life, okay, air gap flux is slightly reduced due to the effect of armature reaction. From the expression for the speed mentioned earlier, it is evident that as the armature current IA increases, speed will decrease by a small amount due to increase in IARA drop. As this is in minus, so it will be decrease. It will decrease the speed. The IA increase, speed will decrease by a small amount due to an increase in IARA drop. Is very small as compared to V. The speed versus armature current characteristics is shown in the figure. But as compared to V, IRA drop is not that much. So obviously increase of I will decrease the speed, but it will not decrease that much. So we can see in the graph, it will decrease very little. The shunt motor being thus more or less a constant speed motor. I repeat, the shunt motor being thus more or less a constant speed motor. So we can see up to full load also we have increased the current, but speed is very little less. So we can say that speed is almost constant. So it can be used in the applications such as driving of line shafts, latches, conveyor, etc. So where the speed to be maintained almost constantly, that type of application we can use DC shunt motor, because we see though we increase the armature current, but speed almost remains constant. So this type of application is for that one where constant speed is needed. Second characteristics is torque armature current characteristics. Now torque armature current characteristics, we can see armature current, if we increase, torque increases directly proportionally, that is we can see almost 45 Now it is 45 degree angle. So at 0 to 0 and continuously it is moving up. So it is directly proportional. The reason is T equal to KT phi into IN. So if I is 0, T is 0, and as IA increases, T also increases, because it is a direct proportional term, we can see. The equation for torque can be written as T equal to KT phi IA. If flux phi is taken as constant, the torque T becomes directly proportional to armature current IA. It is a straight line passing through origin, which we have seen just in the graph. Now coming to the third characteristics, this is speed torque characteristics. So we can see if torque per, that is Newton meter is the unit, if torque is increased, speed is decreased. But it is not decreased up to zero, but some value it decreases. This is the third characteristic for DC shunt motor. The relationship between T and IA and N and IA are as under. So T is directly proportional to IA and N is, you can see there is some reverse condition with IA. And the relationship between speed and torque can be drawn as the figure we have seen. Next, coming to DC series motor. So up to now DC shunt motor is over, now DC series motor we can see. So here this is in series with armature. So we can see from positive point of supply the load current. This is series current. For series motor it is ISC and this is IA for armature. But as we can see, this is the only one loop, there is no branch otherwise. So the same current will follow all over. And this is the back EMF as we have seen in figures also. Here we are starting with our first characteristics card, it is speed load characteristics. So previous time, that is for DC shunt motor, it was almost constant, very small drop was there. But here we can see for series motor it is totally another curve. Okay, so we start from the expression N equal to V minus IRA by KFI. It is seen that the speed N is inversely proportional to flux phi. And for a DC series motor, magnetic flux phi is proportional to IA. So IA is proportional to phi, phi is inversely proportional to N, and phi is also decreasing N. So both effect together we can see. Thus if V is constant, N is inversely proportional to IA, the N versus IA characteristics is therefore a rectangular hyperbola. So we can see this type of curve was there, rectangular hyperbola. Just to see, this is the characteristics curve. We can see this is called rectangular hyperbola. It is seen from the characteristics that the speed decreases as the load on the motor increases. Okay, so we can see here. So if load increases, load means armature current. If load increases, we can see the speed, the value of speed decreases. Okay. The speed decreases as the load on the motor increases. At a very low load, the speed is dangerously high. So this is a point why this type of DC series motor is not directly attached with a load like a belt. It is always put with some gear teeth mechanism. Okay, just let's see. At a very low load, the speed is dangerously high. Thus, if a DC series motor is allowed to run on very light load or at no load, the speed will become much higher than its normal speed, which may cause damage to the motor. For this reason, DC series motors are never started on no load and are not used in the applications where there is a chance of load being completely removed. Two cases, as we can see, if load is very low or no load, speed is dangerously high. We can see from the IA. This is proportional to IL. So if this is IA is 0 or very low, that means if phi is very low, it is at the lower side divided by lower side. So if it is 0 or nearby 0, our total term will be very much high, very, very much high. So for that, two type of protection we can take. Number one is DC motor are never started on no load. So, and number two is, why there is a chance of load being completely removed. So these two conditions we have to avoid, because we cannot let any DC series motor to run with no load. So at the starting or at the continuing, we don't have to take any risk of taking DC series motor with no load or very little load. When the motor is connected to the supply, the load on the DC series motor is connected. Just a minute. I am not using the application where there is a chance of load being completely removed when the motor remains connected to the supply. So, though load is removed, motor is connected to the supply, so it will have a dangerously high speed. The load on the DC series motor is connected through the gears. Okay. The DC series motor is connected through the gears and not through the belt pulley arrangement. This is because in case of failure of belt, the load will be removed from the motor, and thereby the motor will attain a dangerously high speed. In case of load connected through the gears, however, in the event of an accidental release of load, gears will provide some load on account of the frictional resistance of the gear teeth. So because of the friction of the gear teeth, some resistance will be there. So that means the downside will not be near zero, it will be little bit. So there will be a certain value of the speed, not dangerously high. So first characteristics, speed load characteristics. This is number 2. Torque load characteristics. So this is armature current in ampere, which is also called load. This is torque. So there is two different pattern in the same characteristics curve. From here to here we can see this curve, and after the saturation of series field core, we can see the characteristics is almost straight line. So up to here it is curve, and from here it is straight line. This is the characteristics pattern. The equation of the torque for DC motor is given by P equal to KT phi IA. The magnetic flux for a DC series motor is proportional to armature current IA. Okay. So this we have seen that magnetic flux for a DC series motor is proportional to armature current IA. So this is directly IA. This phi is also proportional to IA. So this is also, you can write some constant into IA. So this is one IA term, this is another IA term. So there is two IA term, that is IA square term we can have. The magnetic flux for a DC series motor is proportional to armature current IA, thus the torque P equal to KT IA IA. So T is proportional to IA square. The relationship between torque and armature current is therefore of the form of a parabola, which we have seen that at the starting of the car, how it was this type of shape. With increase in IA, the field flux increases linearly, but due to saturation of the core, beyond a certain magnitude of IA, the increase in the flux is negligible. It is the point of where we are having change of curve from curve to characteristics curve changing from a this type of shape to straight line. With increase in IA, the field flux increase linearly, but due to saturation of the core, beyond a certain magnitude of IA, the increase in flux is negligible. Thus, T is proportional to the square of IA up to the saturation point. T is proportional to the square of the IA up to the saturation point, beyond which T varies linearly with IA. From the top-down characteristics, it can be observed that a DC series motor started on load develops a very high starting torque. Hence, DC series motors are used in applications where high starting torque is required, such as in electric train, hoists, trolley, etc. So, we can see at the starting, with increase of IA, torque is increasing proportional to square. So, where in which application we need very high torque at the initial stage, DC series motor is ideal. This is torque load characteristics, and this is third, that is torque speed, sorry, yes, torque load characteristics was number 2, and torque speed characteristics, this is number 3. So torque load characteristics we have seen, this is number 2. Speed load characteristics is number 1. Torque load characteristics number 2, torque speed characteristics number 3. So as torque is increases, how speed increase, we can see this type of relationship. This is number 3. From the characteristics shown in slide, it can be seen that for low speed the torque is high, and for high speed the torque is very small. For small torque speed is very high, for large torque speed is very less. This is why DC series motor is widely used in the application where motor is to be started on bulk loads. So when speed is less, torque is high. So where there is bulk loads, we can have a lot of use for DC series motor, such as electric locomotive. So where bulk loads is connected, we need this one. Next, after shunt and series motor, the third type of motor is DC compound motor, where it is compound of both of them. So both the coil is there, you can see the current is just as discussed previously. So this is the combination of both two. This is the speed load characteristics, differential compound, shunt, and this is the cumulative compound. So all the three we can have for speed load characteristics. So In commutative compound motors, series field winding is connected in such a way that magnetic flux produced by it helps the flux produced by shunt field winding. Series field is directly proportional to the load current. Therefore, total flux increases with increase in load current or armature current due to the series field in addition to the voltage drop in the armature winding. The speed of DC motor is inversely proportional to the total main flux phi. Therefore, speed drops more sharply as compared to DC shunt motor. We can have the figure. It is decreasing more than DC shunt motor. This is the second characteristics, torque load characteristics. So we can again have the shunt, the differential compound and cumulative compound. The torque developed by a cumulative compound motor increases with sudden increase in load, and at no load it has a definite speed. Cumulative compound motors are therefore suitable where there is sudden application of heavy loads like shears, punchers, rolling mills, etc. The speed of differential compound motors remains more or less constant with increase in load, but its torque decreases with load. Since the DC shunt motor develops a good torque and its speed does not vary, appreciably with increase in load, differential compound motors are not preferred over DC shunt motor and hence are rarely used. Coming to the third characteristics, speed torque characteristics. So this is for differential compound and this is for commutative compound. Now, application of DC motors. DC shunt motor, shunt motors are used in situations such as driving a line, shifting, etc., where the speed has to be maintained approximately constant between no load and full load. In situations where variable loads is to be driven at different speeds, but at each load the speed is to be kept constant, such as driving a latch. This is series motor. These series motors are used in applications such as driving hoists, tennis, trains, etc. As in these cases, a large starting torque is required. They are also used where a motor can be permanently coupled to the load, such as fans, where torque increases with speed, where constant see in speed is not essential. The decrease of speed with increase of load has the advantage that the power absorbed by the motor does not increase as rapidly as the torque. Series motor acquire very high speed at no load or at very light load. This is why this would not be used for a belt drive, where there is possibility of the load decreasing to very small value. DC compound motors are used in application where large starting torque are required, but where the load may fall to such a small value that a series motor would reach dangerously high speed, but the supply voltage may fluctuate. For instance, on a tracking system, the series winding reduces the fluctuation of armature current partly by inductance and partly by its influence on the value of flux and therefore on the induced EMF. When the load is of a fluctuating nature, for example, the driving stamping process, etc., the shunt excitation prevents the speed becoming excessively on light load, and the decrease of speed with increase of load enables the flywheel, usually fitted to such a machine, to assist the motor in delaying with the peak load by giving up some of its kinetic energy. So today we seen how we can control the speed of DC motor, and we have also seen that three type of characteristics are for three type of DC motors, and depending on how we can choose a particular motor for a particular application. Thank you.